Hey you, welcome back to my channel. Today I have a long awaited book haul for you. It's been like 3 months since my last one, so like I said, it's long awaited. I can't believe that it's been so long, if I'm being completely honest. But today I have 26 books for you, and that's not even including the e-arcs and the advanced listing copies that I've received from NetGalley and Libro.fm. We're not even counting those. These are just the books that I've purchased with my own money, the physical books. So yeah, it would be a lot more. It'd be like probably like 40. Anyway, we're not gonna count those though. I just got done saying that. But today I have all these books to show you. I have two different stacks. I have this one right here. Let's see if I can sit it down. Don't fall. Okay, so we've got this stack right here, as well as, as well as this stack right here. 26 books. So, wow, this stack is a lot bigger than the other stack. I'm like, maybe we should evenly distribute the weight here. But yeah, it's a lot. I know. So let's just buckle in, get ready, because I'm going to talk about these books and why I bought them and why I'm excited for them. So without further ado, let's hop on in. All right, so the first book that I'm going to show you today is one that I actually bought today at a used bookstore. Now, I wasn't intending to buy anything really because I knew I already had 25 books to haul. But I was also intending to buy things. I went to the used bookstore with, in mind, a picture of me getting a like classic 80s, like corny, cheesy horror book, like a mass market paperback edition of like those 80s horror books that like you would get at like the dollar store when you went with your parents as a kid, or I would get at the dollar store when I went with my parents as a kid. Yeah, that's what I was looking for because I have been in such a like nostalgic mood. Now granted, I'm not a child of the 80s. I was born in 95, sis, so nostalgia for whom? But I'm the biggest fan of the 80s, like in general. But you add horror into that, 80s horror, and sis, like, that's it. That's all I fucking need. Like literally, it's everything I could ever want. So I've been looking for books because I haven't read a book that was actually written in the 80s about the 80s and horror. So wanted to do that. So that was kind of my plan for going into the bookstore today. However, I ended up with a book from the 70s. Granted, it was 1977. Well, this edition was printed in 1978, but the original book was published in 1977, but you know, I overshot it a little, but I'm still happy because I got The Amityville Horror, A True Story by Jay Anson. Now, I knew that The Amityville Horror was based on a book and based on true events. However, I've never seen the Amityville Horror movie, so I've never really had any strong feeling to read this book. However, when I saw it in the used bookstore, it was exactly what I was looking for, that, you know, that nostalgic feel of a horror novel. And this one just happens to be a classic in horror literature. So I'm so excited to get into this one, even though I haven't seen the movies, which I know. How can I call myself a horror movie fan if I've never seen the Amityville Horror movies? But I was planning on doing it this Halloween season, which I'm already celebrating. I hope you are, because I am. But now I have to read it before I watch it. I mean, I don't have to, but like I'm gonna. I mean, why not? But this edition is just so gorgeous. It's got like the devil's tail. It says, "This book will scare the hell out of you," which was by the Kansas City Star, which I don't know. I guess this book may take place in Kansas. I don't know. Don't quote me on that. I have no idea. It doesn't say it on the back, but that would just be random if it was the Kansas City Star on the front of the book. Like, that'd be really random. But for those of you who don't know what the Amityville Horror is about, like me, before I read the synopsis of this book, I'm gonna read the synopsis aloud to you because I think they do such a fantastic job of capturing what the story is going to be and making me want to read it immediately. So it says, 28 days of terror in a house possessed by evil spirits. In December 1975, the Lutz family moved into their dream home, the same home where Ronald DeFeo had murdered his parents, brothers, and sisters just 1 year earlier. The psychic phenomena that followed created the most terrifying experience the Lutz family had ever encountered, forcing them to flee the house in 28 days, convinced that it was possessed by evil spirits. Their fantastic story, never before disclosed in full detail, makes for an unforgettable book with all the shocks and gripping suspense of The Exorcist, The Omen, or Rosemary's Baby, but with one vital difference. This story is true. How could you not want to read this? Like, honestly. Honestly. And then on the back, too, it has, like, these flies everywhere, but they're raised, so it feels like it's, like, real flies on the book. So it just adds to the creepy factor. Plus, the chapter heads are also covered in flies, and they're, like, in different positions every single chapter. It's just so cool. And then the preface is actually written by a reverend, by Reverend John Nicola. And it just talks about him going into detail about why this novel is important to know about demonic entities and ghostly apparitions and things like that. And I am so stoked to read this book. And I hope I get to it before Halloween of this year, because it would just make my Halloween, obviously. Like, this is a classic. This is a classic. I can't believe I haven't wanted to read this before. But here we are. I have it. And I'm planning on reading it within the next month or two, so I'm excited about this one. So that's why I wanted to share it first. The next book I have, I may have already shown you, but I can't fully remember. And that is Sexual Metamorphosis, an anthology of transsexual memoirs, edited by Jonathan Ames. And this is a vintage original edition of this book. But I got this to read more about the trans community, and it was at a used bookstore for like a buck or two. So I was like, why not? But after flipping through it once I got home, because like when you see a book about a topic you're interested in and it's only a dollar at the used bookstore, you just buy it. Like, you don't really flip through or like look on Goodreads or anything. But after the fact, I did. On Goodreads, everyone has really amazing things to say about it. My only complaint is that all of the trans people represented within this book are white. There are trans men represented, trans women. I don't know if there are trans non-binary people in here, but that would be interesting if there are, but they're all white, which I should have known from the cover, my fault, but I didn't. So I wanted to expand my horizons a bit more than this book is doing, but I'm sure it's a place to start. I'm sure it's great. I'm sure the stories in here are phenomenal, but just not as inclusive as I would have liked. But this is basically, like it says, a bunch of memoirs of, you know, trans people and their experience with being trans. And more specifically, I think within like the 70s and earlier. I don't think it's anything later than the 70s, but I may be completely wrong on that. So we'll see. But I'm excited to read this one someday. Don't know when that day is, because like I said, the fact that it's all white is kind of like, I don't know if I'm already there anytime soon, but it's still intriguing and I do want to get to it soon. But if you've read this, please let me know what you thought in the comment section. So after my kind of flub-up with Sexual Metamorphosis, I wanted to find more books on gender, and that's how I came upon What's Your Pronoun? Beyond He and She by Dennis Barron, whose pronouns are he, him, his. So, as you can see, this cover is phenomenal. It has all of these, I don't know if you can see, it has all of these different pronouns and their links together. And I just think it looks very minimal and cute. But this book just explores gender and its place in society for, I mean, since we could trace back history, really, and in many different cultures. So, oh shit, that scared me. The Amityville Horror really, like, has kind of made me a little nervous. So, see how this goes. But yeah, I'm really excited to read this. I'm really excited to see how the idea of gender came about and the different, you know, gender identities and pronouns that have, you know, kind of come through with time, and where so many of these pronouns and gender identities came from. And I think it would be a really educational book to read, and I'm really excited to get through it. So if you've read this one, please let me know what you thought about it down in the comment section below as well, because a boy needs to know. I'd love to know. But yeah, I'm excited for this one too. The next book that I have is one that I've already read and kind of reviewed on this channel in a wrap up, and that is The Undocumented Americans by Carla Cornejo Villavicencio. In The Undocumented Americans, Carla Cornejo Villavicencio discusses her own identity with being undocumented and her, you know, her life and, you know, graduating from Harvard and using her platform as a Harvard graduate and as an author to, you know, expand her horizons and talk with other undocumented Americans throughout the states and what their experience with being undocumented is. Now, I will say that this book covers strictly like Latinx undocumented Americans, but it's a great, great look at how people are affected differently by the documentation process and by being an undocumented American within America and how they're so easily taken advantage of. And it's just, it was really tragic to read. It was really eye-opening to read. It was beautiful. Carla Cornejo Villavicencio does an amazing job at writing, and she's just so raw and real and really like digs deep and considers things that I, as a reader, was like, wow, like I wouldn't have taken it that deep. I wouldn't have gone that far with it. And she does, and does it so well. And I really, really loved this book, and it gets a 5 out of 5 stars for me. So if you haven't read it, check it out, please, because it's phenomenal. The next book that I have is another book that I've already read and reviewed on this channel in a wrap up, and that is White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. I believe I gave this book a 4 or 4.5 out of 5 stars. I really enjoyed it. It was very eye opening, and you know, while it covers a lot of topics that I've known about before, it also covered a lot of topics that I haven't. Robin also discusses some other texts for white Americans to read within this book. So it opened my horizons, and I'm excited to get to those other books as well. I really enjoyed this book. Gets a 4 or 4.5 out of 5 stars, I can't remember. But if you wanna hear more of my thoughts, check out my last wrap up video that I did where I talk about it. The next book that I have is Lot by Brian Washington. And this is a compilation of stories by Brian Washington about being Latinx and queer, and I believe it's in Texas. Yes, in Houston, Texas, babe. That was so white of me. But this book is super short. It looks stunning. No, it doesn't. It doesn't. I'm sorry, it doesn't. I can't lie. Like, it's not the prettiest cover, but it sounds interesting. And I'm looking forward to hopping on into it. So we'll see what it's about. Other than the fact that it's about a queer Latinx man coming to terms with who he is and experiencing life. Other than that, I don't really know much else about it, but that does intrigue me. So I hope to get to this one very, very soon. The next book that I got is actually one that I got this past weekend. Another one from my used bookstore in my area, McKay's. And it is Faggots by Larry Kramer. And I've heard nothing but amazing things about this book. It's from the author of The Normal Heart, which is a play that I adore and a movie that I adore. But it's supposed to be like the quintessential homosexual read. So I need to get to it very soon, apparently, but I just love this cover. Like, it's so like almost erotic. Like, it's sexy. It's hot. but yeah, it's an older edition, as you can see by the yellowed pages a bit, but I'm excited to get to this one. Again, it just follows the life of a man in New York City coming to terms with who he is as a queer man. So yeah, I'm excited about this one. The next book that I have is one I'm so excited for, but I haven't heard anyone talk about it. So that kind of makes me a little nervous, but overall I'm excited. And that is Meet Cute Club by Jack Harbin. And I'm so excited to read this book because it's a queer love story based around a book club. It's almost like this was written for me. Who knew? No, I'm super excited to read it though. The cover is very, again, like minimal but cute. I love the pink. I love the silhouette of the, well, not the silhouette. I love the outline of the characters, and look at all those books. And it's so short. It's only like 200 pages. So I'm excited to get to this one very, very soon because I think it's gonna be cute and fun, and it's the first book in a series. So I'm looking forward to getting more, even though I haven't even started this one yet, but it's on my radar. I'm gonna pick this one up very, very soon. It's just so fucking cute. How could I not? The next book I have is also one I'm excited for because the cover is stunning, and that is You Had Me at Ola by Alexis Daria. And can we just, I mean, like, this is stunning. The colors, the characterization, the pose, it's just everything. Like, everything I could ever want. So I'm excited to get to this one. This one is about two telenovela stars who start to fall in love with one another. And it's a rom-com, it sounds like. So I'm excited to get to this one. I don't read a lot of, like, contemporary rom-com-esque books, but this one caught my eye. I mean, it's just, like I said, stunning. So I'm excited to get to it whenever I can. This next book, I'm also pretty sure I've already shown you, but I'm gonna do it again in this book haul, so forgive me. And that is Mayhem by Estelle Laure, or Laurie, I'm not sure. But this book is pitched as The Lost Boys meets The Craft. And like I've already said before, I love 80s movies, so I'm excited to get to this book, which is based in the 80s. Even though it wasn't written in the 80s, it was based in the 80s. And it's compared to two of my favorite films, The Lost Boys and The Craft. I watch The Lost Boys every single year, and I recently rewatched The Craft and love it just as much as I did the first time I watched it. So this book follows our main character who is like moving to this new town, and she meets these new kids and she befriends them, and there's a guy who's like murdering women on the beach, and so she gets caught, or kidnapping girls from the beach, and she's getting caught up in trying to find out who it is. And I'm so excited. So fucking excited for this one. Like, I am reading this one in October. This is like the first book I'm gonna read in October because it's just, I mean, it matches that feel. Plus, like I said, I rewatch The Lost Boys every October for Halloween, so this would just go along perfectly with that. So I'm hoping that I love it. Fingers crossed it doesn't let me down, because I really do have high expectations for this one. So I've switched positions because my back is killing me. Who said 24 isn't old, right? So this next book I'm super excited about because I remember Chapter Stacks talking about this book in a video of hers as one of her favorite thriller novels, and I trust her. She led me to Intensity by Dean Koontz, and I really enjoyed that book. So I hope this book hits another home run for me, and that is The Girl Next Door by Jack Ketchum. Now, this book is basically about a group of kids in this neighborhood who hold a teenage girl captive and brutally torture her. And it's based on a true story, and the shocking novel reveals the depravity of which we are all capable. And that just sounds so creepy and so scary. And I thought before I bought this book, which I know I should do better research, blah, blah, blah. But before I bought this book, I had this idea that this was like The Last House on the Left. Like, I don't know why, but I was like, ah, this book is gonna be like The Last House on the Left, and the girl next door is going to be like trapped in her house, and there's gonna be a killer trying to get her. No. But this one sounds a lot more creepy, but I don't know if it's the kind of creepy I'm excited for. Like, I'm kind of nervous to read this one, if I'm being completely honest. It sounds incredibly dark, but like I said, Chapter Stacks really enjoyed it, so I'm hoping that I'll love it just as well. The next book that I have is a Stephen King novel, so you know I'm excited, and that is The Regulators by Stephen King. And this is one that he wrote as Richard Bachman, which is his pseudonym. And it says, it's a gorgeous midsummer afternoon along Poplar Street in the peaceful suburbia of Wentworth, Ohio, where life is as pleasant as you ever dreamed it could be. That's all about to end in a blaze of gunfire and sudden violence, forever shattering the tranquility and the good times here. For the physical makeup of Poplar Street itself is now being transformed into a surreal landscape straight out of the active imagination of the innocent and vulnerable Seth Garin, an autistic boy who's been exposed to and possessed by a horrific otherworldly force of evil, one with sadistic and murderous intent and willing to use whatever means necessary to grow ever stronger. So I bought this book because I do want to collect all of these Stephen King's books in this edition, because I think they're so cute and so minimal, and I love that they all match. But I am a little nervous about this one because Stephen King is writing, as you all heard from the synopsis, about an autistic character who is seen as the villain, the antagonist. And I'm a little worried to see how he does that. In Michael Grant's books, The Gone series, he writes about an autistic character. However, he wasn't so much a villain as he was, you know, kind of a hero and, you know, one of the most powerful people in the phase. So that representation was great, and I'm worried about this one, you know, villainizing people who are on the spectrum, and that makes me a little nervous to read this one, but it does sound interesting. I've heard amazing things about it. I mean, it's Stephen King, but we'll see what I think when I get to it, whenever that is, because I have so many Stephen Kings I need to read, but I will get to it one day, and we'll see what I think. And then the last book from this stack is The Dead Zone by Stephen King. And again, it matches those minimal covers that I showed you a second ago with The Regulators. And this one in particular follows a guy who can see the future. But it just says, when Johnny Smith was 6 years old, head trauma caused by a bad ice skating accident left him with a nasty bruise on his forehead, and from time to time, those hunches. Infrequent but accurate snippets of things to come, but it isn't until Johnny's a grown man, now having survived a horrifying auto injury that plunged him into a coma lasting 4.5 years, that his special abilities really push to the fore. Johnny Smith has come back from the void with an extraordinary gift that becomes his life's curse, presenting visions of what was and what will be for the innocent and guilty alike. But when he encounters a ruthlessly ambitious and amoral man who promises a terrifying fate for all humanity, Johnny must find a way to prevent a harrowing predestination from becoming reality. So, sounds interesting. We'll see how it is. I'm not the biggest fan of like books that have to do with time, so like predicting the future, seeing into the past, things like that. Like, I'm not the biggest fan of that trope, time, you know, whether it's time travel or time, you know, predictions, I guess. I don't know. That's so weird. But we'll see how it's done in here. Hopefully Johnny's able to change time and we'll see what happens. But I'm excited to get to The Dead Zone as well. So the first book from this stack that I have is A Little Life by Hanya Yanagihara. And I am so excited for this one because it's described as like the book that wrecks every booktuber. And I want it to wreck me, kinda, like I'm nervous. It's like over 800 pages. It's a tome, bitch, it's a tome. But, I don't know, I've not cried in a while reading a book, so maybe this one will do it. But I'm nervous as hell because I don't want it to wreck me as bad as I've seen it wreck other people. So we'll see what happens. But A Little Life, we're going to do it. At some point, we're going to do it. So we'll see what my thoughts on this book are. I'll obviously film a reading vlog because this is like the book to do a reading vlog for. But yeah, I'm a little nervous. But yeah, that's A Little Life. But for those of you who don't know what A Little Life is about, it says, A Little Life follows four college classmates broke, adrift, and buoyed only by their friendship and ambition as they move to New York in search of fame and fortune. While their relationships, which are tinged by addiction, success, and pride, deepen over the decades, the men are held together by their devotion to the brilliant, enigmatic Jude. And I love that. Like, Chosen Family is like one of my favorite things in general, not just in books. I have my own Chosen Family personally. And yeah, I love that. And so I'd love to read about it, but I'm also scared. So wish me luck. We'll see what happens. The next book that I have is There There by Tommy Orange. And the synopsis of this book says, Tommy Orange's wondrous and shattering novel follows 12 characters from Native communities, all traveling to Big Oakland Powwow, all connected to one another in ways they may not yet realize. Among them is Jackie Redfeather, newly sober and trying to make it back to the family she left behind. Dean Oxendine, pulling his life together after his uncle's death and working at the powwow to honor his memory. 14-year-old Orville, coming to perform traditional dance for the first time. Together, this chorus of voices tells of the plight of the urban Native American, grappling with a complex and painful history with an inheritance of beauty and spirituality, with communion and sacrifice and heroism hailed as an instant classic. There There is at once poignant and unflinching, utterly contemporary and truly unforgettable. And after reading A History of My Brief Body last month, I wanted to read more by Indigenous authors. And Tommy Orange is an Indigenous author, and he's also writing about Indigenous characters. So I'm excited to get to this one and, you know, broaden my horizons and my understanding of the Indigenous communities, because I don't have the best understanding right now. So I would love to, you know, learn more by reading through this book. So yeah, if you have any recommendations about books that are by Indigenous authors about Indigenous characters, I would really love to hear your suggestions down below, because I'd love to get into more of them. So yeah. Next book that I have is The Kite Runner by Khalid Husseini. And I have read A Thousand Splendid Suns
by Husseini, and I love it so much. I've read it like 3 times already, and I've never read The Kite Runner, which is his most famous book, so probably need to get on that. So yeah, I know it's been adapted into a movie. I know that everyone read it like back when it was released, except me apparently. The synopsis of this book doesn't really give much away on what it's about, but I've heard amazing things, so I don't really need to know much going into it. The next book that I have is one that I've already read, and I will be talking about it in my coming wrap up, and that is Night of the Mannequins by Stephen Graham Jones. And this is a short novella, and I thoroughly enjoyed this book. It works as like a commentary for horror fans. It's like almost like an ode to horror movie fans, and it's got all the tropes, and it's almost like a satire because it's hilariously funny. And I really enjoyed my reading of this book, and it was wild and weird and funny and all the things that you could ever want. And if you're a fan of the horror genre, I highly recommend that you check out Night of the Mannequins by Stephen Graham Jones. The next book that I have is also by Stephen Graham Jones, and that is The Only Good Indians. And I'm so excited for this book. First of all, I love the cover. Can we talk about it? And again, Stephen Graham Jones is an Indigenous author, and in this book, he is writing about Indigenous characters. I believe the main character of this was also Indigenous, but I think it was only mentioned like one time. But with this one, it seems to be a pretty prevalent part of the story. But it says, The Only Good Indians follows 4 American Indian men after a disturbing event from their youth puts them in a desperate struggle for their lives. Tracked by an entity bent on retribution, these childhood friends are helpless as the culture and traditions they left behind catch up to them in a violent, vengeful way. So I'm just looking forward to this. I think it's going to be phenomenal. I've heard nothing but amazing things. So yeah, I'm just excited to get to it. So let me know what you thought down below, because I know you probably read it. Like, everyone's read it at this point, right? But I'm kind of holding off to read it until November, when the Literally Dead Book Club is reading it. So I'll be reading it then. But I'm so excited for this. So let me know what your thoughts are down below. I would love to get even more hyped about this book than I already am, because I'm so hyped for it. The next book that I have is The Troop by Nick Cutter. And this book is like the epitome of body horror, is what I hear. So I've not really been the biggest fan of body horror. Like, I loved the Saw movies, don't get me wrong. I have liked a few other like gruesome movies, but I've never really pinpointed that and been like, yes, that's what I love in horror movies, is the gruesomeness and the grotesqueness, and you know, the body horror. But this one seems to be all about the body horror. So it's kind of like an experiment for me, like to see if this is something that I like. Like I said, I've liked movies that I've seen that involve body horror in the past, but I've not, you know, read a book where that was kind of like the thing going for it. But it says, once a year, Scoutmaster Tim Riggs leads a troop of boys into the Canadian wilderness for a weekend camping trip. A tradition as comforting and reliable as a good ghost story around a roaring bonfire. But when an unexpected intruder stumbles upon their campsite, shockingly thin, disturbingly pale, and voraciously hungry, Tim and the boys are exposed to something far more frightening than any tale of terror. The human carrier of a bioengineered nightmare, a horror that spreads faster than fear, a harrowing struggle for survival with no escape from the elements, the infected, or one another. Dun, dun, dun. So I've heard amazing things about this. And then I've also heard some mediocre things. So I'm excited to give it a go and see where I fall on the spectrum. But yeah, it's more of an experiment, so we'll see what I think of it. The next book that we have is one that I'm super excited about, and that is the one by John Mars. I have The Passengers by John Mars, which sounds phenomenal to me, but the one sounds just as, if not more, phenomenal than The Passengers does. And this book is basically about a future where there is an app that you can find your one true love and your soulmate, and people are going on this app to, you know, find their true love and to date them. And then some people are doing it even though they're in happy relationships. They're like, well, I still want to see what my one, who my one is. And some people are using it to kill their one. So it sounds like a really thrilling and fun story. Like, it sounds like a Black Mirror episode, and I'm living for it. So I'm excited, so excited to get to this one very, very soon. The next book that I have is also one that I've read, and it's one that I read the arc of, that was sent to me by the publisher through NetGalley, and that is One by One by Ruth Ware. And I got the Target exclusive edition, which has an extra chapter that's like a prequel chapter. So it follows some of our characters before the events of the story take place. And like I said, I've already read this book. I gave it a 3.5 out of 5 stars. I thought it was okay. I did enjoy myself while reading it. However, it just didn't live up to the hype that I had built up for it after reading The Turn of the Key literally the month before I read this. So yeah, I wanted more. I did. I was very, very disappointed while reading this book, but you might love it. If you're just now getting into thrillers, I think you might love this book, if it's like your first one, because there aren't really any twists. So it's just kind of like your out of the gate thriller. But if you read The Turn of the Key and you loved it, you might not be as big a fan of this one, in my opinion. But it was fun nonetheless, and I don't regret reading it. But I wish it was more twisty and more, you know, intriguing to read. That's all. So One by One is about a music streaming company that goes on a ski trip, and one by one, they are picked off and killed by a vengeful murderer. So that's pretty much all you need to know going into this one. The next book that I have is one that I'm so excited about, and I started reading, but I kind of put it down because I had other things that I wanted to read more. And I know that makes it sound bad, but it's not. I'm so excited for this one. And it is The Brightlands by John Frahm. And this is pitched as like a gay Stephen King thriller, and I'm all about it. John Frahm is queer, and he's writing about a queer character who goes back to his hometown and is faced with some harsh realities about, you know, going back to a small town after living in the city and being openly gay and things like that. And things are going awry very quickly, and he has to find things out. And that's pretty much all I know, literally all I know. But I'm excited about it. I've heard nothing but amazing things. So if you haven't checked it out, definitely do so. It's The Brightlands by John Frahm, and I'm excited to get this one very, very soon. So the next two books I have are by the same author, and that author is CJ Tudor, which I've never read a book by, but I have two books from her now, and that is The Chalk Man and The Hiding Place. And if I'm being completely honest, they both kind of sound very, very similar. However, I've heard amazing things about them. I've seen good reviews on Goodreads, so I'm excited to get to them. Plus, they both deal with teachers, and I'm a teacher. So that would be interesting to read thrillers about teachers. This one's specifically an English teacher. It doesn't specify what kind of teacher this one is, but it'd be great if it was an English teacher. But this book talks about our main character, Eddie, and how he and his friends growing up would kind of leave chalk man drawings to like lead someone somewhere. It's like kind of trails and stuff. Until one time they go down this chalk man trail, and they find a dismembered body. And then now Eddie has come back into town, and he's learning new things about what really happened, and he's coming to terms with that and trying to figure out what exactly happened on that day. And then The Hiding Place is kind of a very similar story. Joe comes back to town with secrets, and he's teaching, and there are a lot of people who want him to leave town or keep his secrets secret, but he really knows what's going on, and he's, you know, trying to find out everything so he can take it to the police. But we'll see what happens with this one. I don't know. But those are the books, and they seem interesting, and they were like $3 at the used bookstore, both of them. So I couldn't really pass them up. So I've heard really good things. We'll see how they go. But just let me know if you read them, what you thought down below. And now we are on to our last book of the day. It's already been so long, I know. On my camera right now, it says it's been 50 minutes. So I'm sorry that it's been so long. But the last book that we have is one that I'm sure you all are super excited for, and that is Home Before Dark by Riley Sager. And this is the fourth Riley Sager book that I own. Oh, I love that. That's cute. That's really cute. Anyway, come on, sis. So this is the fourth Riley Sager book that I own. I have only read one, and you don't even know about that. I read Lock Every Door this past month, and I am posting a reading vlog for it very, very soon. But all you need to know is that I didn't love it. Like, I actually kind of like despised it a little bit, and everyone is gonna kill me in the comments because everyone else loves it, but I was not a fan. However, Home Before Dark sounds interesting to me. It's about kind of like a haunted house, and it's about this girl whose father wrote a book about the house that they lived in when she was little, and it was like a horror book, and it's kind of like almost like the Amityville Horror a bit. but she goes back to this house to see if her dad was really experiencing these hauntings or if he kind of made it all up. And she's experiencing some freaky things, but she's wondering what it is that's behind them. Is it a creepy demonic possession of a house, or are there other people working to scare her? We'll see, but I'm excited for it. Like I said, I didn't love Lock Every Door, but this story sounds interesting, and everyone that read Lock Every Door still prefers it to this one, so I'm hoping that this one I will love for the reasons that everyone else didn't love it as much as Lock Every Door, because I hated Lock Every Door, like genuinely did not like it. But enough about that. You'll see my reading blog for it when I post it. But that's it for this video. I really hope that you enjoyed it. Please let me know down below what books you're excited for me to get to first. Please do all that down in the comments below, because I would love that, sis. So other than that, that's it for this video. If you liked it, please give it a big thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And also, hit that post notification bell so you are notified every time that I post a new video. My name is Brandon, and I'll see you next time. Bye.